You're watching BBC News. You join us as the US Senate is preparing to vote on the appointment of Brett Kavanaugh, President Trump's deeply controversial nominee for a seat on the Supreme Court. Let's take you live to the scene now in Washington as Democrat Chuck Schumer speaks. Let's listen in.
The distortion of our founding.
The Sergeant at Arms will restore order in the gallery. Continue.
Mr. Blake. Mr. Gardner.
Aye.
Mrs. Gillibrand.
You're watching live coverage of the U.S. Senate, these nomination proceedings for confirming the very controversial
Harris.
Judge Brett Kavanaugh as the new member of
Ms.
the Supreme
Hassan.
Court judge. But what you've been hearing is multiple interruptions by protesters in the gallery as the names of senators are read out. You hear the sound
come in,
some of the protests being
Heller.
Muffled, and then on it goes. Let's talk to our correspondent Barbara Plett-Usher, who's at the Capitol building in Washington. Barbara, how unusual are some of these scenes and what we've been hearing?
Well, all of this is capping what's been an intense and I don't know if you can say unprecedented, but unusual political drama that's played out over the past week or two. And you heard the statements there from the minority and majority leaders, both putting out very radically different views of this judge that they were about to vote on, which sums up what this debate, what this controversy has been all about. Plus, of course, as you mentioned, some protesters managed to get passes into the gallery and tried to disrupt as much as they could. But the two kind of speeches we heard talked about very different things. So the Chuck Schumer, the Democratic minority leader, he went through all of the reasons why the Democrats thought this wasn't right. He talked about Judge Kavanaugh's conservative views, which concerned Democrats. He talked about Judge Kavanaugh's partisanship as they see it historically, but also exhibited in the hearing last week when he was charged with sexual allegations of assault. They talked about this, the examination into those allegations having been incomplete, and concerns about his temperament, all of these things that the Democrats have been saying. And then he switched into a pitch for the election because he knows that he's lost this case, but the Democrats are hoping to galvanize their supporters through this. And then the majority leader, Senator Mitch McConnell, who's been fighting very hard to get Judge Kavanaugh confirmed, went through a completely different speech. He talked about the qualifications that Judge Kavanaugh has, that he is exceptionally qualified, he has a good record on the court, a serious scholar, a committed mentor, and so on. And then making the point of saying that this is really about justice and fairness. He said earlier, we saved an innocent man. His argument being that this was mob rule, these were allegations that were unconfirmed, and why should they destroy the character of a man? And we have come through. Quoting Susan Collins, the senator, the female senator, who was quite concerned about this and sat on the fence for a long time, using her to make his point that Judge Kavanaugh should be confirmed. So you're seeing the sort of wrapping up of a dispute, a controversy that has completely divided the Senate and also divided many Americans.
We are seeing scenes now, Barbara, of the U.S. Senate. We believe that final vote may actually be underway. We've been hearing the names of senators being called. And you talk about those final two speeches of Chuck Schumer and Mitch McConnell. And I thought what was interesting about what Mitch McConnell had to say is that a vote to confirm Judge Kavanaugh is a vote to end this dark chapter in the Senate history.
Mr. Scott.
Yes, I noticed that as well, and that is something that I think we will wait to see what happens. But many senators have said, including some on the Republican side, that this has been a very dark chapter. It has been bitterly partisan. It has been nasty. Nobody came out well on this in terms of the way the events unfolded. And I guess the question is whether the two sides can work together in the future, or whether this rift over the judge and the way it played out is just going to deepen divides that are there. The Senate, I think, traditionally tends to work together better than even the House of Representatives. They are seen as a sort of more senior, more kind of bipartisan institution, or at least one that can work together in a more bipartisan way. And in fact, they have done on some issues. But something like this, which brings together an issue of the Supreme Court, which involves the direction of the country in the next generation. It brings together issues of sexual allegations that sort of intersect with the Me Too movement. Has really sort of and fires up the bases on both sides, has served to deepen those splits rather than otherwise. And the question is whether that can be fixed after this vote takes place.
Barbara, we're still seeing scenes of the U.S.
If he were present and voting,
Senate,
he would have voted aye.
We are hearing instructions. Let's just have a quick listen about what's happening.
The pair will not change the outcome of the vote.
You're watching live scenes of the U.S. Senate as this confirmation vote has taken place. We've heard a list of those in the affirmative, those who are voting for Judge Kavanaugh to be the next U.S. Supreme Court judge. And then we've heard a list in the negative. We are hearing on Reuters that a majority of the U.S. senators have voted in support of the Supreme Court nominee. But we'll get confirmation of that as soon as we can. Barbara, can you explain a little bit about the process here, what we've been hearing and what might happen next?
Well, the vote has finished. It is 50 to 48. Judge Kavanaugh has been confirmed. Now, the reason it's 48 is because the senator from Montana was not able to be present because he had to attend his daughter's wedding. So the senator, the one Republican senator who voted no, voted present for him, which kind of evened the balance there, which is why you have 50 to 48. But that's a sort of minor side story to the fact that the vote has gone through, Judge Kavanaugh has been confirmed, and the next step will be for him to be sworn in and take his seat on the bench, which court observers have suggested could be as early as Tuesday.
So Judge Brett Kavanaugh is now to be the new U.S. Supreme Court judge. So is this it? Is this where the story ends?
Well, that's where this chapter of it ends. But I think it has triggered a lot of other things that will continue over the next weeks and months. I think, and as we've been talking about, perhaps the soonest we'll see it is in the midterm elections. We'll see in 5 weeks whether this is still as hot an issue as it is now. It certainly has fired up Democrats who say that they are going to come out in larger numbers to vote. And you heard Chuck Schumer's pitch there to vote. They're using it as an election issue at this point. So in that sense, that could have a lasting impact. Certainly in the wider sense about the direction of the Supreme Court, yes, this is just the beginning because this means there is now a solid conservative majority on the court of 9 judges. The judge that Judge Kavanaugh is replacing was, of course, conservative, but he was sometimes be known to have a swing vote. He would sometimes side with the liberals on certain issues. Judge Kavanaugh has a very clear record of conservative positions on all the issues that will be coming up before the Supreme Court. And it is something that is not only a victory for President Trump, who promised his supporters that he would do this, but for conservatives who have organized since the 80s to try and shift the direction of the Supreme Court, working with lawyers, getting them promoted, getting them, bringing them into the limelight, trying to get people on the bench that will change its direction. So in that sense, it is very much a pivotal moment for the Supreme Court.
Barbara, what can often be confusing when we talk about the U.S. Supreme Court process and the court itself is that we talk about not wanting partisan judges, and yet both sides try and get their own sort of partisan pick on the bench. How is that conflict resolved?
Yeah, it's a difficult one because the Supreme Court, popularly, the judges are appointed by the president. And so if an opening comes up, whatever the party the president represents, he or she will choose somebody who reflects his or her values. That is very much the dynamic that has been all along, and that does raise the kinds of questions that you've asked. I think there have been mitigating factors before. For example, in the Senate, it used to be that you needed 60 votes to confirm a judge.
Are there any senators in the chamber who wish to vote or change a vote? If not, on this vote, the ayes are 50, The nays are 48. The nomination of Brett M. Kavanaugh of Maryland to be an Associate Justice of the Supreme Court of the United States is confirmed. Majority Leader.
I ask consent the motion to reconsider be considered made and laid upon the table, and the President be immediately notified of the Senate's action.
Without objection.
I suggest the absence of a quorum.
Sergeant at Arms will restore order in the gallery. The clerk will call the roll.
Mr. Alexander.
And you've been watching scenes there in the U.S. Senate. Mike Pence has just confirmed the vote 50 to 48. And Barbara Platt-Usher is still with us. Barbara, we just heard that Mitch McConnell said the president will be immediately notified.
Yes, and I think that we can expect to hear from the president shortly. He spoke briefly before before the vote on Mr. Kavanaugh, in which he said he would be watching it on television. He said that Judge Kavanaugh would make a great Supreme Court justice, and he also said that the week's delay in the vote because of the FBI investigations into these sexual assault allegations had been a positive thing. The outcome had been positive. So we may hear more of that when he speaks formally, but certainly this is the outcome he very much wanted, and as we've discussed earlier, this is a political victory for him.
Right, Barbara Platt-Usher there on Capitol Hill for us, summing up and giving us analysis on what we've been seeing. These are the protests outside the Senate. You can see a number of people gathering. They've been there for a number of hours. We believe anti-Kavanaugh protesters. And you heard during that whole Senate vote, people in the public gallery interrupting that vote, crying out. A call to order had to be said a number of times by Vice President Mike Pence. So it's been a divisive day, a controversial day, and no doubt a day that many will not forget on both sides of the aisle. Let's have a chat now to Natasha Esro. She is a professor of international politics at the University of Essex. She's also an American. Natasha, what do you make of the scenes that we've been seeing?
Well, everything having to do with the confirmation of Kavanaugh has just been incredible. Shocking at times. It's been a roller coaster. As you see, there's been so many twists and turns. But in terms of the scenes that we're seeing, I think with this Kavanaugh confirmation, it's been one of the most controversial confirmations, you know, in the last century. Prior to that, that might have been the confirmation of Clarence Thomas, which you saw 52 voting in favor and 48 against. But in that case, there were 11 Democrats that actually voted in favor of Thomas, who's a very conservative justice. In this case, it was incredibly partisan. In the end, we did see Joe Manchin, a Democrat, voting for Kavanaugh. But the response, you can just even hear it in the gallery, so many people protesting, and they had been protesting all week, worried about what the Kavanaugh confirmation could represent. It's definitely roused up the Republican base positively in that they feel very energized by this confirmation, but in turn, it's also roused up Democrats who are incensed by what has happened, not feeling that the investigation by the FBI, the final investigation, was really properly done. And we're seeing this as sort of a symbol for how divided the U.S. is at the moment.
Professor Esro, as an American, is this something that you have not seen before? And what is it that you think about your country when you watch these scenes?
No, I've never seen anything quite this divided before. Nothing like this, nothing quite as controversial about the confirmation of a Supreme Court justice. You recall not long ago, Neil Gorsuch, a Republican, was confirmed. There was not that much fanfare about that, even though he's quite a conservative justice. But with the Kavanaugh confirmation, there was so much about this that was really, really emotional and really highly charged. It seemed to be dividing up men and women in some ways as well, and it was on the heels of the Me Too movement, where there are concerns that women aren't being listened to when they come out, and there was so much attention on the hearing and millions of people watching the hearing that took place, where Kavanaugh tried to defend himself and Dr. Blasey Ford told her story. I think it's completely riveted the nation, but been very, very sad as well, very heartbreaking to see the U.S. be so divided, so partisan.
Professor Ezra, when it comes down to it, what do you think that this essentially was about? Was it about the sexual assault allegations, or was it about the temperament of Judge Kavanaugh, or was it just about the politics?
Well, for the Democrats, they had trouble with him from the beginning because they were worried that he was going to be incredibly partisan. They were concerned that if we have a constitutional crisis where Trump may try to pardon himself, that Kavanaugh was conservative enough and partisan enough, and he has even stated that he believes sort of in pretty expansive executive powers, that he would vote in favor of sort of supporting Trump in whatever his defense is of himself. So for the Democrats, pretty early on, they were worried about how partisan Kavanaugh is. Then as the Blasey Ford allegations came forward, there were concerns about whether or not he had actually assaulted someone, and therefore he would not be fit to be on the Supreme Court. And then when he finally had his hearing, you started to see Democrats really concerned not only about his partisanship, but about his temperament, that it was a job interview, as many as the Democrats said, and they felt that he was being rude and disrespectful and defiant, and at times sort of yelling at them, and that he just didn't really have the appropriate temperament to be on the Supreme Court.
All right, Professor Natasha Ezra, thank you very much for that analysis. Let's go now to Julianne Thompson. She's a Republican strategist, and she joins us now from Washington. I'm sure you've been watching all the scenes, Julianne, but one of the things I wanted to ask you was that the Senate Minority Leader, the Democrat Chuck Schumer, described this as this one of the saddest days in the history of the U.S. Senate. Would you agree with that?
Well, I think that this entire process has been sad. I think that we witnessed a man being torn apart by the politics of personal destruction. And I think that Senator Schumer was at the head of that. And I just think that it is a positive day for America that in the end, the Senate came to their senses. They voted based on judicial qualifications and not based on personal destruction, not based on the fact that they ideologically disagreed with Justice Kavanaugh. And the fact of the matter is, had they concentrated during the hearings on their ideological differences, I think that America would have reacted in a much different way than it did. But what they did was they used this opportunity to try to destroy him personally with unfounded, uncorroborated accusations. And Senator Feinstein even brought a Hollywood starlet, Melissa Milano, to sit behind Judge Kavanaugh during the confirmation hearing. She's involved in the Me Too movement. She's also a very famous actress. And the entire purpose was to make this a media show, was to make it a hit job on Judge Kavanaugh. And her goal was to get a lot of cameras on Melissa Milano and to try to change the narrative of the entire hearing, of it being on these unfounded allegations rather than his judicial qualifications. And for a while they were successful, but in the long run they were not, and I'm thankful for that.
Are you concerned, though? Was there ever a point when you heard these allegations and saw the reaction by other women who are victims of sexual assault? Was there ever a point where you thought that perhaps Judge Kavanaugh isn't the right person for the role?
No, there's never been a time that I thought that, because I've never believed that Judge Kavanaugh was guilty of what he was being accused of. I believe that Dr. Ford may have been sexually assaulted by someone at some time in her life. I don't know that for sure, but I certainly don't believe that it was Judge Kavanaugh. And there were just too many things surrounding the accusations, too many inconsistencies in her testimony, combined with the fact that all of the witnesses that she gave said that they had no idea what she was talking about. This was completely uncorroborated. But in the long run, I feel like the Democrats used Christine Blasey Ford. They never told her that the Republicans would actually fly out to California to interview her. They kept that from her. They used her as a pawn for political purposes. And I think that it is a shame, because in the long run, the way that they treated her and the spectacle that this turned into took the Me Too movement, which I originally agreed with the tenets of, but it took that movement and it took the victimhood of people that truly have been sexually abused, and it took it backward, because the American people watched what happened and they saw this turn in to, as I stated before, the politics of personal destruction. And it has been a very sad time in this country over the past couple of weeks.
Julianne Thompson, we're just seeing live pictures of some of the protests, the anti-Kavanaugh protests that just continue outside the court. One of the other issues that was raised with Judge Kavanaugh was the partisan nature of his defence, his personal defence at the testimony. What do you think of that, that people have said that a judge shouldn't really be partisan or shouldn't reveal if they are, and they ought to be truthful when they're being questioned by the Senate? Did that ever concern you?
Well, I believe that he was truthful when he was questioned by the Senate. You have to understand that this man was put through something that no other Supreme Court justice had ever been put through before, and it was only natural that he would be defensive of himself. He and his family, their information was put out at large. People knew where they lived. They wrote graffiti on their home. His children were in danger. He suffered death threats. His family suffered death threats, combined with the fact that they were tearing him apart based on false, uncorroborated allegations. It was only natural any human being, man or woman, would have been defensive under those circumstances.
Julianne, as a Republican now, what are you hoping to see from Judge Kavanaugh? He'll be officially confirmed shortly, and then he'll sit on the bench. What do you want to see going forward?
Well, I think that Judge Kavanaugh has probably learned a lot from this experience. I mean, I believe that Judge Kavanaugh is one of the most qualified members of the judiciary that has ever been confirmed to sit on the Supreme Court. But aside from the qualifications that he's already had, I believe that what he went through during this process has strengthened his belief system when it comes to due process and when it comes to the rights of the accused. We live in a country where you are innocent until proven guilty, not guilty until proven innocent. And I believe that it has strengthened his belief in that system and in due process. And I have high hopes for him as a justice.
Right, Republican strategist Julianne Thompson, thank you very much for your thoughts on what has been an extraordinary day, an extraordinary week, really. But let's just show you these pictures again. We're seeing those protests happening outside the Senate. Judge Brett Kavanaugh is now the new Supreme Court Justice, and that vote has taken him through 50-48. So that has just happened really in the last 15 minutes or so. But let's talk to Celinda Lake, and she's a pollster for the Democratic Party. She joins us now from Washington. Celinda, your thoughts as you watch this unfold?
Well, I find it very, very depressing and very, very sad for our democracy. I think, first of all, we now have confirmed on the Supreme Court someone who the majority of Americans believe should not have been confirmed, including a very solid majority of women. By 20 points, women think that he should not have been confirmed. We have someone who has been accused of very, very serious misbehavior and sexual assault, and we did not have a process that did the thorough kind of investigation and vetting that should have been called for. We have a critical time in our country where now I think our country is more polarized than ever, and polarized, frankly, at the expense of women and at the expense of our daughters and our sons and our core democracy. One of the things the analysis of of Judge Kavanaugh is missing is he's disqualified for the Supreme Court, not on his ideology, not even on the sexual allegations, but he's disqualified for his character and his honesty. He lied under oath to the Senate committee. That is disqualifying, and 2,400 law professors in the entire United States, an unprecedented action, said that he is not qualified to be judge. Here is someone who's going to decide the fundamentals of our democracy, the fundamentals of our rights, who engage in a partisan, personal, completely inappropriate response to legitimate questions that were being asked, and a very thoughtful testimony that was being raised about actions that he had taken. He lied about his drinking. He belonged to societies that I can't even mention the names of these societies on this television. They would be bleeped out. He used sexual innuendo in his writings. These things should have been investigated, and he lied about them. That's the most fundamental condemnation. I think it's a long way to healing process now. I think, unfortunately, this process will elevate fundamental doubts, particularly among women, about the fairness and impartiality of the judiciary. But I think Senator Schumer had it right. There is one recourse in our democracy, and that is our vote. And people need to get out in the midterm elections. It is estimated that 40 million Americans who voted in 2016 were not planning to vote in 2018. We need those 40 million people to show up to vote.
Celinda, one of the things that you've heard said on the Republican side and Judge Kavanaugh's supporters is that those allegations that were brought forward by Dr. Ford were simply not enough to meet a legal threshold. And then you also heard Mitch McConnell read out almost a CV saying this is a highly qualified judge.
Well, he certainly has a lot of judicial credentials. So do many people in the United States. There should have been a serious, full investigation. It shouldn't have been a three-day investigation where the White House took most of the relevant topics off of the table. And it's a sad day, frankly, because the FBI is a very respected institution in the United States. This is a lifetime appointment. This man will be on the bench for 30 years plus. He will rule on laws that will last for all of the rest of us for the rest of our lives. We should have taken more than 3 days to investigate this. But more to the point, under oath, he lied to a U.S. Senate committee, and there is ample evidence of that. That should have been disqualifying. His nomination should have been pulled, and someone else should have been nominated. And there is no question under this administration that whomever they nominated would have been very conservative. This is about core character, and this is about the process of our democracy.
You have heard Republicans state time and again that they don't believe Judge Kavanaugh lied, and they also believe that the Democrats orchestrated a lot of what happened and took advantage of those allegations. What do you say to that?
Well, there are just as many, for all the Republicans who say they don't believe the charges, there are just as many people who say they do believe the charges. That's why we need a thoughtful, independent investigation. And if this man is going to be on the Supreme Court for 30 years, we ought to be able to take more than 3 days to investigate these allegations. So that question of who said and who's right should not have been left to people's individual opinions. We have a process. We have an impartial, expert legal system. This man, if he were being nominated for any of our security posts in this country, would not have been passed. But he's going to be on the Supreme Court, distinguishing between all of our laws and our Constitution. We should have taken more than 3 days to investigate it. It's not a matter of whether you believe or not. There are facts here that could have been discerned. But again, my fundamental point is, the minute that Judge Kavanaugh lied under oath to the Senate committee, he was disqualified. And that would be true whether it was a liberal judge, a conservative judge, or someone in between.
You're watching BBC News at the moment. We've been speaking to Celinda Lake, the Democrat pollster at Lake Research. Now, you are watching live pictures of protests happening outside the Senate. Brett Kavanaugh, Judge Brett Kavanaugh, has been confirmed by the Senate as the new Supreme Court judge. We just want to bring you this tweet in the past few minutes. Donald Trump has said, "I applaud and congratulate the US Senate for confirming our great nominee, Judge Brett Kavanaugh, to the United States Supreme Court. Later today, I will sign his commission of appointment and he will be officially sworn in. Very exciting!" Exclamation mark. And we are actually, we'll no doubt hear from Donald Trump as he head to Kansas for a rally there. Celinda Lake, if we move forward to the political implications now, what do you think they're going to be for the Democrats, especially as we approach the midterms?
I think it's yet to be determined, but I think there are three factors. First of all, we see energy on both sides. So in the end, it will depend on who turns out to vote. For all of the 2017 and 2018, the Democrats have been far more enthusiastic than the Republicans. Kavanaugh and Donald Trump have energized the Republicans. And so now it's a real fight to see whose vote turns out to vote. I will say this, that usually anger is more motivating than victory. So we'll see what happens. But Donald Trump is very, very able in terms of leading his political party.
And
secondly, I predict today that we're going to have a record gender gap. Men and women are going to disagree in their vote at twice the rate that they normally had, including married men and women. And thirdly, we have a record number of women candidates running, and I believe this will propel a record number of women winning.
And Celinda, what about those Democrats who are in states, representing states where Donald Trump won, where there are a lot of Donald Trump supporters? Do you think there's going to be a backlash against the Democrats?
I think it depends a lot on the person. Senator Tester, I'm originally from Montana. Senator Tester is my senator. That state went 20 points for Donald Trump, but it is a state where he has had a very thoughtful conversation with his voters, and I think he will be returned successfully. You have Heidi Heitkamp, who made a very difficult decision, a woman senator from North Dakota, one of the most conservative states, already behind in the polls. I think voters will respond to her character and her principles, that she made a decision based on what she honestly believed was right for the country, not what would be good for her political fortunes. You have Lisa Murkowski, a Republican in Alaska, taking a very courageous stand, the only member of her party to do so. So I think people will judge this individually, but this is going to add intensity, no question, to these fights and these campaigns in the last 3 weeks of the election.
Going forward, just briefly, looking at the Supreme Court itself, do you think now that an institution that is so very trusted by Republicans and Democrats now is going to perhaps lose some of its shine?
I think it's a very sad time because we are very, very polarized in this country, way more polarized than is healthy for our democracy. And the Supreme Court, as you noted, was the one institution that people thought was independent, impartial, and fair. Now perceptions of the Supreme Court are going to be very divided by gender and by party. That's a sad day for our democracy. And what I'm hoping is in the 2020 elections, that the Democrats will be able to nominate and win with someone who can bring our country together.
All right, Democrat pollster at Lake Research, Celinda Lake.
Thank you.
Celinda, thank you so much for that analysis. And you've been, of course, watching all of the coverage out of the US Senate. Judge Brett Kavanaugh is the new Supreme Court judge. And in the last few minutes, Donald Trump has tweeted, "I applaud and congratulate the U.S. Senate for confirming our great nominee, Judge Brett Kavanaugh, to the United States Supreme Court. Later today, I will sign his commission of appointment and he will be officially sworn in. Very exciting. That's the latest tweet from Donald Trump. Much more coming up on BBC News. Stay with us.
Good evening.